Wow. Look at you. Stunning. Are you crying already?
Yes.
We are. All right. It's totally allowed. It's your wedding. You can do whatever you want. PJ, you look beautiful.
Thank
Absolutely
you.
Radiant. And the venue going on is awesome. Incredible. Who gives this beautiful woman to be married today?
My brother and I do.
All right. And would you give your daughter a kiss on the cheek? And would you place her hand in Zach's hand? Zach, would you receive your bride from her father? All right. Good. Well, thank you guys for being here today. It is an honor, and I invite you to have a seat as Zach and PJ's pastor. I pastor City Mark Church. My name is Steven, and I've been privileged to pastor PJ and Zach now for the last couple of years here. And it's been a really great opportunity to get to know these guys. And I know that all of you have been touched by their lives in one way or another, either friends or family with Zach or with PJ, somehow connected. You may not know their entire story, though, and so I want to just kind of fill you in a little bit if you don't know all of the details of how they came together, just so that you have a better idea. And this is good for you guys, too, because there'll be a day, right, when you wake up and you say, "Whose bride idea was it for us to get married?" And you'll need to remember this moment and this story. Because what you're standing here today to tell all of us is that we believe God has brought us together. We believe that God has shaped us for one another. And that all the days the psalmist says that were ordained for us when you were fashioned, Zach, in your mom's womb, and Mary was carrying you, and all the days, you know, when your mom, Mary, was carrying you and you were fashioned in her womb, the Bible says all your days God foresaw, he foreknew, and that he was forming you and shaping you and creating you uniquely in his image, but also for this day. And so I asked kind of the story here, and PJ and Zach kind of gave me a little bit of their perspective on how they met. So if you don't know the whole story, I'm going to share a little bit with you. PJ said, we really met, and talk about God's kind of fashioning and shaping this thing, because I just found out that, Brian and Zach, your moms met in the hospital, when they were giving birth to you guys, which is crazy. All right, so Zach and Brian have been friends since childhood, basically, and they used to be a part of a group that used to torture your sister.
Yes.
When she was a lifeguard.
All of you.
Yeah, and so she was a lifeguard in the pool, and you guys would torture her. I can see why that was a huge romantic draw for you towards Zach. Totally get that, but Sam and Brian, your sister Sam, ended up marrying your best friend Brian. And so before they did, though, they were dating. And Brian, you threw a New Year's Eve party back in 2011. I heard it was quite the party we didn't talk, because I asked for Brian as well. The things you learned. But Zach said he was invited to the same party. Your best friend had invited you, and Sam, PJ's sister, had told you that her sister, PJ, was going to arrive at the party later. You've never met PJ. And he says that he remembers standing in the living room with a full view of the front door, kind of like this, when she entered. And he, quote, unquote, I just read them like they come, folks. He said she was a gorgeous blonde hipster bombshell. All right. Well said, sir. He said, "I couldn't believe it." And he said, drunkenly, he put in parentheses, "Sorry, pastor. Sorry." He said, "I yelled in front of everyone, 'That's PJ? That's PJ.'" And PJ, now you inserted, you said when I walked in, you said I immediately jumped into the crowd of people dancing. No surprise there. He said, and she said, when the song ended, I heard some crazy guy in the background say, "That's PJ?" She said, so I went over and I introduced myself to Mr. Zach Holiday. And PJ, I think that you had him at hello. Because Zach said, after you introduced yourself, from then on, he said, I spent most of the night trying to be around her and just as much as I could asking her questions. And evidently in the conversation, you told him that you had taken French as a foreign language in high school. Is this right? So Zach attempted to say everything that he had ever learned from English, failing at attempted romantic whispers in her ear. PJ said something like Zach thought he was saying romantic things. And his attempt to tell me he wanted to dance in French, he ended up saying something like, I looked hotter than a French croissant. I don't know. No, I totally made that up. Totally, it's funny. Right, so, but I'm sure you butchered the French pretty bad. Zach said the next time that I saw her, it was like 2 weeks later at a birthday party, and he said, I didn't have any of the courage that I had last time. To be clear, we are referring to liquid courage, is that right? Yes. So he was lacking the courage, but you said you were not lacking one thing. You were clearly carrying with you an embarrassing memory of speaking random French phrases in my beautiful stranger's ear. He said, she, PJ, truly experienced the shy Jack who lacked all confidence. And PJ said a few weeks later, she said, I signed up for a difficult Spanish class. And I don't know what the thing is with languages with you guys, but she said, I needed a Spanish tutor, and Zach is pretty much fluent in Spanish and had taught himself, much like French. So I asked him if he could help me study, and she said he was so gifted in French that's why I picked him for Spanish as well. So, yeah. So Zach said, no, this really was a language that I actually knew and spoke. And so he got a text, I believe, from PJ. You asked him over a text, would he tutor you in Spanish? And Zach said, I got the text from PJ. She asked if I would tutor her. He said, without the slightest pause or without the suspenseful, cool waiting period before you respond back to a text, he said, I just fired back. Absolutely. Absolutely. And he said, once a week then, you guys started for the course of her class. You would meet at Starbucks, and you would tutor her. And I love what Zach said. He said, still today, I do not know why PJ thinks that people tutor attractive blonde girls for free without alternative motives. He said, I guess she just thinks guys are just nice like that. He said, I eventually got the point across. Wanted to hang out without the Spanish. And PJ, you said, you know, I really hadn't considered dating someone like Zach at the time because you had differed on so many different points in your life, things that were of key values for you at the time, and just things that he just wasn't there yet. And so you weren't convinced that you should date. But eventually, she said, we ended up hanging out outside of studying. And the first time, she said, the atmosphere shifted. The atmosphere shifted. And she said, we went on our first unofficial date the very next night. Zach, you described that night as one amazing night because whatever you did with the Spanish worked, because by the end of the night, PJ asked to kiss him. The atmosphere. She said, and so Zach, you said she asked to kiss me, and I love this. You said I was always trying to be a gentleman with her, and so I declined since we had a few beers that night, but she apparently thought highly of that. She just kissed me anyway. And I love this. He says, my confidence was back. Better than it ever had before. So, to be clear, that is not liquid courage. We call that lip courage, baby. That's lip courage right there. So, PJ, she said, that was the greatest kiss of my life. And I knew, I love what you said. You said, I knew that he was significant. Significant. Dude, you must have some kind of lips. I don't know what significant lips. I don't know what happened. So the atmosphere has changed. And Zach, you said that was on a Tuesday. And come from, what guy was that, by the way? What guy? You just lost like dude points, right? All of us. Right? I should win dude points when you know the name, the day. But all right, it was a Tuesday. And come Friday, he said, I told her how I always felt about her. And she was still unsure. He said, to be honest, it took me being the most persistent man that she had ever known. She just wanted you to believe that, man, because you had her at Pucker Up. But you were persistent. And he said, 30 pounds less later, because all of his attention, he couldn't believe all of his energy was going on to getting you to give him a chance. And he said, eventually she was persuaded. And we finally were together. And Zach, you said, I was the happiest I had ever been in my life. And what you're saying today is that God knows that you're better together. And truly, that you cannot fully become the man that he wants you to be without a helper in your life. And PJ, you're saying that to become all my dreams, all my vision, all that God has destined for me to be, I can't do that completely alone. That's true. It goes all the way back to the garden where God says it's not good for men and women to be alone. It doesn't mean everybody's supposed to be married. Not everybody will. It does mean we need significant people who love us, who are faithful to us, and will be loyal to us in our lives. And so you're saying, God knew, and He shaped and destined the story that you would be together. I love it. Straight out of the movies. God's movie, at least. Ecclesiastes 4, 9, and 10 says this. Two people are better off than one. Right? Not just married, but two people are better off than one, for they can help each other to succeed. That is God's plan and intention for you, to help one another succeed. You're better together. What the scripture says is if one person falls, the other can reach out and help. But someone who falls alone is in real trouble. And so God says, it's not good for man to be alone. You're better together. And you're saying, we believe we're God's choice for each other to help one another succeed, to accomplish His mission, His purpose in our lives. PJ, you shared some of how you finally knew that you guys were God's choice for each other, the right fit for one another. And I love that she said, I think I loved him immediately. I told you, man, you had her fucker up. It was right in. She said, I don't have an exact memory of knowing when exactly he was the one for me, except that it just always felt that way. He was really different, you said, and he was so kind. And she said, there's no greater man that God could have paired me with. He's everything that I wrote in my journal about as a young girl. And it was something that I just knew when I met him. I think that we told each other I love you in the first week that we dated. Mush. You guys, you're that couple that everybody was grossed out by, right? Yeah, I told you, man, you lost it. Okay. Yeah. I asked Zach, I said, when did you know, right? When did you know that PJ was right for you and that she was God's perfect choice for you? He said, it is said only that it's only in the movies, but he said, it's true. I felt that I always loved her. He said, she is the most unique and wonderful person that I have ever encountered. She saved my life in every way. And PJ, he said, she was my initial rock, and my motivation to become better is still the man that I still strive to become. It's exactly God's purpose in putting me together. Zach said, I remember dancing in the street in front of her house and then watching her sitting on my trunk and listening to her recite one of her favorite poems. And he remembered one of the lines that he recited out of the poem. And the line was, let's contemplate jazz together. That is so PJ. Let's contemplate jazz together. We don't know what that means, but we love it. You said, Zach, that she is such an individual and a strong one at that, and she is. She was the answer, Zach said, to any and all prayers that have been prayed for me. And I know that sounds exaggerated, but he said, I cannot say it enough. She was meant for me. And we believe that you are. And you are meant for one another, because when God brings two people like you together, Zach and PJ, He does it not just because you fit one another, but it's also because you help to shape one another. That just uniquely in the way that He has purposed marriage to work, it is, in His economy, not just about our happiness. That's a shallow value that our culture has embraced. God's purpose for marriages is infinitely and intrinsically higher and deeper. It is that you would shape one another and that you would help one another succeed, and that you're the primary tool, apart from the Holy Spirit, in each other's lives that will help Zach to become the man that God has intended, call out the best in him, and Zach to help PJ reach her dreams, her destiny, and all that God's called her to be as a woman. And so God fits you together, but He puts you together not just because you fit, but also to sharpen one another. Truly, this is the part of marriage that is valuable, it's powerful, but it's not always fun. You sharpen one another. The scripture says it's one of God's ultimate intentions for marriage. And I love this scripture where He says, as iron sharpens iron, right? So one man, or in this case, a woman, can sharpen another, right? So one man and woman can sharpen one another. And in marriage, you will consistently sharpen each other in ways that you can't imagine. Zach, I asked you, I said, what are some of the ways you already see that you know that PJ sharpens you? And he said, you know, I was working a minimum wage job. I love your honesty.
I'm sorry.
I do. He's just a real guy. I love his transparency. He said, I was working a minimum wage job. He said, I was drinking way too much, way too often, smoking cigarettes. He said, I had not really had God at all in my life, not intimately, for about 5 years. And he said, PJ, I love this. He said, PJ was the light that shined from the top of the well of which I was standing at the bottom. Something like that. That is good. He said, she helped me to find my old self. And then, PJ, I heard at some point after you were the light at the top of the well, then you laid the gauntlet. That's how they do it, brother. Yeah, they're the light first.
She's got to be.
So she put the gauntlet down, and he said, she told me that I would either be in church every Sunday or else I would not be dating her. Well done. Well done. He said, and then his response was, I found God. Yes, sir. We are quick to convert when it matters.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. But you were sincere. You really did find God again in your life. And you felt the movement of the Holy Spirit and how he was drawing you together and what he was seeking to do in your life. And instead of fighting that, you said yes to it. He said, I did everything to prove that I was worthy of her after that. I continually strived for better jobs and positions. I cleaned up my act. 3 years later, she has made me a better person in every way, although I'm sure I'm still a work in progress. And we are. We all are. You said, I will always seek to be a better man for her and repay her for saving my life. Powerful. Yeah, now I'm going to cry. Zach, PJ said some of the specific ways that you sharpened her. She said, Zach teaches me perseverance in relationships and how to take the good and the bad and to love people anyway. You told me you've experienced some real relational pain in your life and at times it's been a challenge trusting people, just experiencing trust. And you said that Zach has had lifelong friends, Brian, just true proven lifelong friendships through the ups and downs. You said that he's often reminded you that no one is perfect, we are all flawed, and that I will have to endure hardship sometimes to have lasting relationships, because most often the good outweighs the bad, and people are worth fighting for. So true. It's going to be true in your marriage, too. It'll be worth fighting for, even in your imperfections and flaws. You said that he's also very level-headed, and today you said he helps you to think more rationally instead of so emotionally about situations. It's one of the chief callings on a husband for a wife. It truly is, because we're shaped differently. I am probably, you said, more emotional than most people. You said, I think it has to do with the fact that I make art and I write poetry, and emotionalism is a requirement for artists. Right? So you said, Zach is so calm and gentle that he protects me from saying things that I don't mean in the heat of a passion or emotional moment. You said he's been the first person in my life who could understand my wild emotions, at times even celebrate them, and even though they were different feelings that he may not have understood. And then as she was writing this to me, she said, it makes me want to cry right now. She said, because this hits so home to you. And you said, to have someone say that it's okay for me to be myself, but to also help me to grow beyond myself, to tame my tongue, to be slow to speak and slow to wrath. You said that is a priceless gift that Zach gives you. You said it's a gift from me, from God to me, to have someone understand me and even endure me sometimes. Yeah. That is true of all of us, right? Yeah, that's the nature of a godly marriage. You sharpen one another. But sharpening at times will bring peace, and at times sparks fly when metal touches metal, right? Two strong people. And at times the sparks will fly. When the sparks fly, and sometimes it hurts to be sharpened, remember this, right, on those mornings, on those days, because Colossians says, it just as you're clothed today, just adorned, right, and took all this effort to look so nice, the Apostle Paul says, on those days when sparks are flying, clothe yourself. Remember this day. And clothe yourselves just like you did for this wedding. Except clothe yourselves, he says, with compassion, with kindness, with humility, with gentleness, and with a lot of patience. Right? And then he says, bear with one another. It's the language of childbirth. Right? It's painful. It's long bearing. It's suffering. Bear with one another, he says, and here's what you do. Forgive each other whatever grievances you may have against one another. And when the one that loves you the most, right, has the most access to your heart. And the one who loves you the most and has the most access can also hurt you the most. Right? They have the treasure. And so when you fail one another, when you wound one another, when you sin against one another, how do you forgive one another? And Paul says, forgive, this is the secret, forgive as the Lord has forgiven you. As much as you need the mercy of Jesus in your life, Zach, that's what you quickly extend to your wife. PJ, as much as you need the grace and mercy of God to keep growing and keep learning, keep taming the tongue, keep, right? As much forgiveness as you need from God, liberally pour it out to Zach. Forgive as the Lord has forgiven you. You both have faults, right? You both are going to make mistakes in your marriage. You both bring baggage into your marriage from your journeys, right? And the scripture says it is the glory of man to choose to overlook an offense, right? God is always about covering. He is always about blanketing. He's never about exposing and making it more raw. He's always a healer, and it's always to restore. And so be about that in your marriage. Fight for one another. Overlook one another's wrongs. See the best in one another. And fight for one another, not against one another. You're going to fight. Right? So when you fight well. Right? She knows the gauntlet down. So when the hammer falls, right? Fight for what is worth fighting for. And here's what you need to remember. You're never the enemy. You're never the enemy. You're God's gift to one another. There is an enemy who will come against your marriage. He is real. Sometimes he'll use people. He'll use things and circumstances. You have an enemy that hates the idea of a man and a woman committed to one another for life under God. He doesn't like that picture because it's one of God's favorite pictures, right? And it's an expression of Jesus' commitment to us and his love to us. So you'll have these fights. When you fight well, right? Fight well. Fight for what matters and for the relationship. And so Ecclesiastes says this, fight back to back, right? Fight back to back, knowing that the real enemy is not one another. It's the stuff that you're wrestling with, right? So Ecclesiastes says a person standing alone can be attacked and easily defeated. But when two stand back to back, they can conquer. And three are even better, for a triple braided cord is not easily broken, right? Mm-hmm. Triple braided cord is a strong rope. And your relationship with Jesus Christ, the presence of the Holy Spirit through Jesus, is the third strand in your marriage. He is the third cord that causes it to be strong. PJ Zach said some of the ways that he sees Jesus in you and Christ in you that sharpens him. He said that you demonstrated a real relationship with Jesus in him. Not a religious one, not rules and hoops and legalism and all the religious stuff, the hoops you got to jump through to perform for God. But you demonstrated a relationship that's truly based on grace with Jesus. And you had grown up, Zach, you said, in a church setting that, at least for you, felt personally more condemning. It just was a condemning environment. And you felt personally condemned. You said that was only made worse with the condemnation that grows stronger when you abandon your relationship with God. And the truth, you said, that comes from mercy. And so you just experienced that kind of condemnation. And Zach said, PJ has helped me learn that Jesus really came for the sinner and not for the righteous. That grace means something real, that forgiveness is a real thing that I can grow from, that my life could be something more. And every time I'm with PJ, I thank God that he sent her to me. In my darkest moments, I would ask God for a sign or a way out. And it took me a while to realize that she, or at least Jesus in her, was the answer to that prayer. Zach, PJ, she said that she sees Christ in you. She said, in all of your realness and all the flaws that you talked about, right, we all have, but within all of that, that she sees a purity of heart in you that regardless of any flaws has always been there. It's just there in you. She said you have a calming effect that's always been there. When you were a baby, about three, your twin sister fell off a counter, I think, and hit her head. It was serious enough that an ambulance had to be called. You came out of it, but yeah. The ambulance had to be called. And like right in the moment, as a three-year-old, you put your hand on your mother's back, and Mary back says, it's going to be okay, Mom. She's going to be just fine. Right? That peace-giving spirit is in you. That's wired, right? By God. It's part of who you are. And she sees Christ in that in you. She said that you were born with this wisdom, it seems like, on how to perceive situations and not to panic about them. She said it's like Jesus when he was questioned and haggled, and the Pharisees were trying to trip him with trick questions. But Jesus remained calm, and he never answered out of frustration or pride. And she said, I see that in Zach. He doesn't do that. He's like Jesus in that he has that ability. So keep nurturing the presence of Christ within you and in your marriage. Keep nurturing your relationship with Jesus, because ultimately we're all here to bless your marriage, and we're going to pronounce a blessing on your marriage, and God will honor that. It's part of the mystery of the miracle that he does here. But ultimately, Jesus Christ is the only one that can bless your marriage. Right? He's the only one. Because it's not a pronouncement from the preacher. The blessing of God is not just a piece of paper or something that signs, not just a legal arrangement, right? It's the presence and the activity of God in every aspect of your marriage. It's what Adam and Eve had when they walked in the garden before they flubbed it up, right? It was God involved in their walking and in their talking. He was the friend. He was the third cord. He's involved in your family planning. He's involved in your finances. He's involved in what you do and where you go. He's involved in all of it, right? He's the center. He's at the table with you. That's the blessing of God on your marriage. It is his presence, his activity in the marriage. And the only requirement to experiencing that blessing before we take vows here is to respect, and this is my challenge to you, is to always respect the sensitive spiritual nature of this union. Respect the spiritual nature of your marriage, because it's not a social relationship. People say all the time, why do I need to get married? It's just a piece of paper. Oh, it's so much more than that. It is the blessing of God on your relationship. It's not just legal. It's not just a piece of paper. There is an invisible spiritual force that is present right now that does the miracle of taking two, not half and half, a whole man and a whole woman, and then making the two one. That is the miracle of the Holy Spirit. And so you can't achieve ultimately real intimacy in your marriage, right? Without the blessing of God on the marriage. We try, right? If all the sex we want and all the intimacy we want could achieve true intimacy, right, in marriage, America would be the most intimate nation in the world. Right? But that doesn't create intimacy. And so people jump from relationship to relationship looking for the intimacy that is missing. And what's missing is the presence and the uniting factor of the Spirit of God in the relationship to do what only he can do between two people, right? To keep forming, keep shaping you. And so respect the spiritual nature of your marriage. Invite God to be the one in control of your marriage. Yield control of your marriage to him. And here's the alternative. If you don't, right, here's the warning. If you don't, then when you don't place God first in your marriage and you don't yield control of your marriage to him, what will ultimately happen is you will fight then for control of one another, right? Because we don't trust him with control of my husband. I don't trust him with the control of my wife. I need to seize the control, right? And so you'll fight for control of one another. It's two wills fighting for the control of the relationship. Two wills, two broken wills. But when two wills will surrender to one will and yield your hearts and your lives and your marriage to one will, then it is so smooth. It's so much easier because there's one perfect will that you're united under. And we're not fighting for control of one another. We're seeking to be under the control of the God that loves us and that brought us together. And so this is my charge to you. Right? And you've chosen to come now and make a covenant together on holy ground, right, in the presence of God, the presence of your family and friends and these witnesses. And with this charge in mind and the sobriety of the covenant you're about to take, Zach, do you understand? And do you accept this responsibility? And do you promise to do your very best each day to create a loving, a healthy, and a Christ-honoring marriage, not by your power, but as you flow in the power of the Holy Spirit that's available to you? If so, would you say yes, sir?
Yes, I do.
Okay. And PJ, do you understand and do you accept this responsibility? Do you promise to do your very best each day to create a loving, healthy, Christ-honoring marriage through the help and the partnership of the Holy Spirit in your life? If so, would you say yes, I do?
Yes, I do.
All right. Okay. And PJ, would you, well, do you want to maintain your flowers?
Oh, no, no.
Okay. Then, Zach, we're going to start with you. The Bible says that as the husband, you are the leader, right? Not the boss. Right? You might even, everybody knows the woman is the man that turns the head, right? We've all seen the movie, right? Right. So what he means by head is that you are the protector, the covering, right? And you're the lead. So you're the spiritual lead in your family, and so you start with making the covenant first. Zach, would you look into PJ's eyes, and from your heart, would you repeat these vows? I, Zach, take you, PJ. To be my beloved wife.
To be my beloved wife.
My constant friend.
My constant friend.
And my love from this day forward.
And my love from this day forward.
In the presence of God, our family, and friends.
The presence of God, our family and friends.
I vow to be your faithful partner.
I vow to be your faithful partner.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
In joy and in sorrow.
In joy and sorrow.
I promise to love you unconditionally.
I promise to love you unconditionally.
Support you in your goals.
Support you in your goals.
And honor and respect you.
And honor and respect you.
And I will cherish you for as long as we both shall live.
And I'll cherish you for as long as we both shall live.
PJ, as you look into Zach's eyes, would you repeat these vows from your heart? I, PJ, take you, Zach. To be my beloved husband.
To be my beloved husband.
My constant friend.
My constant friend.
And my love from this day forward.
And my love from this day forward.
In the presence of God, our family, and friends.
In the presence of God, our family, and friends.
I vow to be your faithful partner.
I vow to be your faithful partner.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
In joy and in sorrow.
In joy and in sorrow.
I promise to love you unconditionally.
I promise to love you unconditionally.
To support you in your goals.
To support you in your goals.
To honor and respect you.
To honor and respect you.
And I will cherish you as long as we both shall live.
And I will cherish you as long as we both shall live.
All right. And do you have rings to give to one another? Okay. Goodbye. Yes. Best man does have it. All right. It's beautiful. The wedding ring is a beautiful symbol of what God intends for marriage. It's a symbol of never ending. It's sort of a symbol of eternity. There's no beginning, there's no end, it just continues. It is the nature of what God desires for a marriage, that it would be for all of your life. But it also means something else, because the metal that creates this ring, the precious metal, it's been refined. And what makes it beautiful is that it's been refined by fire. And it's been hammered, and it's been pounded, and it's been shaped and chiseled, and the heat has melted, and it's taken out the impurity and the dross, and it's truly been refined in the fire. It's purified. Mm-hmm. It's a beautiful symbol of what God does through marriage. It's just like gears fit together to make things work, but it'll chisel off as iron sharpens iron, those rough edges. And the longer you live together, and the longer you walk in a relationship with Jesus together, the more God will use PJ to shape you, Zach, and to knock off the things that don't look like Jesus in you. And that's painful, but you're being refined and you're being purified. And when most people give up on a marriage, is in that process. And so PJ, Zach, right, there'll be days where God's using him and you'll look at him and go, I don't want to see Jesus in him today, right? He'll be shaping you, and you'll be being purified and refined and becoming better and stronger and better and stronger, right, as you do this in love for one another. And so this is the symbol that God has given us in marriage and that we commonly use, and it means something else. It means that you're committed to one another through your failures, the worst of sins and failures, and the greatest of your successes. Because what Jesus says is marriage is a picture of my relationship to each of us. Right? So the ring is perfect because Jesus says, when you say yes to me and invite me into your life, he says, I put the ring on. And he says, we're the bride of Christ. And Jesus says, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. And Jesus puts the ring on. He says, I'm in it with you until the end. And at times you'll be faithless and you'll let go of my hand. You may even take the ring off, but Jesus says, I'll never take the ring off. I'm in this forever. This is why the Apostle Paul says marriage is a picture of the covenant that is never ending between Jesus and us. Let your marriage be a picture to the world of that kind of loyalty to one another through failure, through ups, through downs, through sins and successes. So Zach, as you place this ring on PJ's finger, PJ, remember this covenant and the symbol of the ring all the days of your marriage. And Zachy, would you repeat after me? PJ, I give you this ring.
PJ, I give you this ring.
As a symbol of my trust.
As a symbol of my trust.
My respect.
My respect.
And my love for you always.
And my love for you always.
All right. PJ, you have a ring for Zach.
Yes.
Okay. You already have it.
Oh,
okay.
Sorry.
Oh, sorry. Got it. That's for pity. Oh. Okay. Would you take that and place it on Zach's ring finger and repeat after me? Zach, I give you this ring.
Zach, I give you this ring.
As a symbol of my trust.
As a symbol of my trust.
My respect.
My respect.
And my love for you always.
And my love for you always.
All right. And would you repeat this together out loud? These rings will now seal the vows of our marriage.
These rings will now seal the vows of our marriage.
And our promise to never leave or forsake one another.
And our promise to never leave or forsake one another.
As long as we both are living.
As long as we both are living.
So help us God.
So help us God.
All right. Ephesians 5:31 says, when a man comes to his wife and a wife comes to her husband, that you leave your parents in essence. It says that a man leaves his father and mother, and you leave your father and mother, and you are joined together and united as one now. And you cling to one another first. And so we've got a common expression, a beautiful symbol of that in our culture, which is the unity candle. It's two families whose lives crossed paths a long time ago, as God would ordain. And now you're symbolizing that though you will always be part of your families, that God is forming a new family. And as you light the unity candle together, that it symbolizes you're becoming one in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Spirit, please build my trust with that
Lord.
This is a beautiful thing and a beautiful couple and a beautiful moment before God. And so we just want to pray, all of us, as an extension of our love for you and our sincere desire for a prosperous and beautiful and healthy and love-filled, joy-filled marriage. We want to pray a blessing over you. And so I'm going to ask your maid of honor and your best man and all of these attendants just to come and just stretch that hand of blessing. You'll place your right hand on her shoulder and her left hand. And as an extension of these witnesses, would you join us in prayer and just join in extending your hand and heart and blessing to them? Let's pray. Well, Father, we thank you for Zach and for PJ. God, I thank you as their pastor that I've gotten to just see their hearts and their sincere love for one another. Father, I see the joy that they have and the love that they have for one another, and also their love for you. God, watching how they're growing and how they've just come into a really safe and beautiful place with you and their relationship together. And so, Father, we speak blessing over this marriage. We align our words with your words, and we say, let nothing that God has joined together, let no man, no enemy, no spirit divide us under. Father, we join our words with your words that say, no weapon formed against your children shall prosper. But that what God has purposed, every plan and every good gift that you have for PJ and for Zach shall come to be. Father, your word says that you know the plans that you have for them. Plans to give them success and a future and a hope and a destiny. Not to harm them. As long as they walk in your ways and in your light, Father, that you will lead them to good paths. So, Lord, we ask and we speak over their marriage that you would make the rough places smooth and the uneven places even. Father, that you would make every road the right road, that you would go before them and light their path. Father, bless them with unity and peace and joy. Father, may they have a home filled with children's laughter and just dreams being fulfilled, Father. Through the ups, through the downs, through the hard, through the easy days, God, through all of it, sickness, health, riches, poverty, whatever may come, Father, that it would be a blessed marriage. And so, Lord, we speak your blessing over them. And as Joshua spoke the blessing over his people in your name, we declare, may the Lord bless you and keep you, Zach and PJ. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. May Jesus be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and your home always. And may he give you peace in your relationship and in your hearts all the days of your life. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right. Well, PJ and Zach, thank you guys. Now that you have promised yourselves to one another by the vows that you have exchanged, it is my highest honor now to pronounce you husband and wife in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. You are now husband and wife, and you may now change your Facebook status. Not what you were hoping for. She's wanting those lip-courage moments. All right. So, Zach, this is the moment that you've been waiting for. Everyone else, don't screw it up. You may kiss your bride. I'm most excited just to have him with me and getting to call you by her pet names, which are Bear and Bubby. She said, I feel like we are going to be better together than apart. I love that. She didn't know what I was going to say today. And she said, I feel like life is finally going to really begin once we're married. And you said, PJ, I know it's going to be a great adventure to be with Zach. And I'll be so incredibly blessed, and it's going to be so incredibly beautiful. Amen. And Zach, you said, I am most excited about just being with her, waking up next to her, watching TV with her, laughing, crying, even fighting with her. I'm excited, he said, to pay bills with her. I'm excited to adopt a cat as my own. That is true love right there. He said, I'm even excited about those days where we will annoy one another. I'm just looking forward to building a real life with her. And I just want to live day to day, every day with her and only her. And so because of that, we believe that you will. And it's going to be an awesome marriage. And so we bless you. We give it up for you. And it is my highest privilege to now introduce to you for the first time, Mr. and Mrs. Zach.
Thanks for being here.
You're killing it.
Yes. Thank you.